Everyone,
good afternoon,
morning.
Everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Giuseppe Carlo Marano from Politecnico di Torino. Professor Marano, welcome to SIMPAR 2021, and please, you may start your presentation.
Thank you very much. I am really pleased to be here to get some of your time. I am going to do a brief speech on whose title is Machine Learning Methods for Structural Rehabilitation Design. And first of all, anyway, I would like to thank all the committee that permit me to participate in this conference. So the Federal Università de Caera, and all the companies and organizations that support this very interesting and very relevant conference, SIMPAR 2021. And I am going now on a very brief summary of my presentation, my speech. And after the greetings and the acknowledgements, I'll give some details about the main description of machine learning, artificial intelligence, and machine learning applied to structural engineering, the different paradigms, and with a specific focus on soft computing and how the soft computing, and specifically the evolutive or also known meta-heuristic algorithms, can help us in a very basic question in many areas subject to a high seismic risk, that is the vulnerability assessment and upgrade of existing buildings that are not able to satisfy the minimum requirements in terms of safety against the seismic risk. Well, I am going to do a very preliminary introduction of machine learning. And what we can say is that machine learning and generally artificial intelligence, it is the main description, the main ideas of all those techniques, is going to be a common practice in many fields of technology, and it has been widely used in many different tasks, especially in more recent sciences. Its diffusion in civil and specifically in structural engineering is in some way not so fast, as it tends to substitute the analysis of a problem with the human brain with something that we can generally define, maybe I'm wrong, as a computer brain that learn from his own expertise without getting or using an analytical formula. That is one of the main advantages, or the main peculiarity that we have in structural engineering, that is one of the oldest field in engineering. Maybe we are speaking about the first applications in structural engineering has been done more than 200 years ago. So it's a well-defined science, and it has a very strong technical background, the structural engineering. This is a power for many aspects, but sometimes is a problem, as we are not so open to accept a totally different paradigm like the human-like intelligence. So while we can use something different from our well-defined and well-known formulas for describing the physical problem we have to deal with, with a different approach, a totally different approach that is a totally unconventional paradigm with respect to the what we are used to learn and teach at the university, at the first, since the first year of the university. So let's see a very brief description on what we are speaking about. What is artificial intelligence? What is the difference with machine learning? What is deep learning? And well, the field is an evolutionary aspect, and so we have no a single way to define everything, but commonly we define the artificial intelligence as the way to the try to simulate a human-like reasoning, so to get a sort of intelligent behavior and totally autonomous decision making. So we are speaking like you, maybe something of you remember HAL 9000, the computer of the science movie, the science fiction, where a machine overcome the human decisions. Okay, machine learning is a subset. Okay, and it represents only a part of the artificial intelligence. It can be defined as the as a way to get the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. So there is no way a model, a mathematical model, able to support the decision and the learning model. Okay, so computer program which learn from experience, from the data that we have from different sources, so from experimental data, for simulation data, and so on. Okay, and so a sort of automatic discovery of hidden regularities and relationship from data. So this is also well known as pattern recognitions. In this field, quite interesting for structural engineering, is the is going to be for the application in structural health monitoring, the malfunction detection with machine learning technique. Inside machine learning, we can see a smaller subset, still a small subset, that is a deep learning, that is a part of machine learning, which focuses on a specific tool that is widely used in machine learning, that is the deep neural networks. So the classification of many intelligence computational techniques start from pattern recognition, that, as I just tell you, is a technique in which the main goal is to classify different objects into a number of classes or categories. And pattern recognition can be seen in this flow chart as a generative model, so start using the probability density function estimation of different phenomena, or different way to discriminate models with a decision boundary estimation. Now the machine learning is inside the pattern recognition, that is a part of machine learning. Machine learning is major subfield of artificial intelligence, dealing with the study, design, and development of algorithms that can learn from data itself, so just from data, okay, and make prediction using learning data. And in this case, we can divide the machine learning in three main subtasks: the supervised, the unsupervised learning, supervised learning, the unsupervised learning, and the reinforcement learning. And here you can see clearly the whole the different applications that we can do. So the supervised learning, that means we learn by examples to the computer, to the program, giving the some examples where we have a flag, where we have a classification, so we can learn by our indication in some way, is about regression and classification. Regression getting is means to get to find a way to reconstruct data from with a regression, or classification is means to recognize data that came from different that can be divided in different fields. The unsupervised learning means that the computer learns without any indication, so just from data, but there is no any flag, any classification in the data. And so the application, main application is clustering. And the reinforcement learning is a sort of mixed way where the learning is reinforced by some added results. And it is generally based on the agent-based models. And the deep learning is the branch of machine learning that is composed of networks that can learn unsupervised from structured or unlabeled data. And so we can see here the division and the application that we typically have of machine learning. In this case, we can just see in a more visual way, so the supervised learning, so the classification, the regression, and so classification you can see, so divided the results from different sources, okay, and recognize automatically without a specific metric, so a specific mathematical tool that is able to, from a formal way, okay. The regression, we have a huge number of applications. Yes, supervised learning is the clustering, so automatic clustering without, so recognize also how many clusters are there, and if any, and how many clusters are there. So the density estimation, that is a central problem of many structural applications. So dimensionality reduction, so understand what is the more relevant parameters. In some way, we can say variational analysis to see if some parameters are more important than others in a given problem, just to reduce the dimension of the problem and to be more and to make it easiest to be solved. And in this case, the reinforcement learning that is a sort of mix between them. Here, to show how this area of research is growing up, just an estimation of the number of papers that has been published till 3 years ago in different areas. Using pattern recognition or machine learning. Okay, this is from an analysis done using the Scopus database. And being absolutely fast, here there are some more details about the supervised learning. So we give some training data with some labels, and the machine learning algorithm is able to interpret it, to do a new evaluation on new data that has no labels in this case. We can apply this supervised learning both in classification and regression problems. And for instance, a typical problem where we can apply those techniques is, for instance, in the classification of damaged or undamaged situation in a specific structure. So having the getting the a decision support for the maintenance of bridges or other structures, just having a different probability on the event of possible damage inside it. Okay. In this case, the reinforcement learning is the use of agents, and you can see here a sort of example of clustering. So you have a number of data, the algorithm is able to recognize if there are some clusters. So if they are closer, yes, it's quite intuitive in a two-dimensional space. It is quite harder where you have tons of data, so hundreds or millions of data in a high dimensional hyperspace. In that case, it's not very easy, and it could be absolutely the only way to deal with those amount of data using such an algorithm. And you can see here, for instance, in structural health monitoring, where the machine learning or the artificial intelligence techniques can be used where you can get together different problems that deals with different aspects of structural engineering. So from the finite element models, from the data analysis and interpretation, from the decision, the actions in case in about the life cycle and about the performance. And in this case could be absolutely interesting use the, for instance, just to get a very fast window on the application of artificial intelligence in structural health monitoring. We can use artificial intelligence for parametric and non-parametric identification. That is both two are quite common problems in structural identification. So to get the model updating and in case, so to recognize the structural behavior, the structural characteristics of in this case of a bridge of in general structure, and then also trying to evaluate the the possible area, the possible location of damage that are inside the structures. And this is a flowchart able to give you the main aspect of the starting from time series data from a monitoring using a parametric or non-parametric approach to the to do an identification as I showed you before. And now let's go in a more detailed way to the central point of the central aspect of this presentation. It's about soft computing, that is a sort of a number of mathematical applications, mathematical methods that are not related to the classical ones. So let's say in a very rude way, without a gradient, so without the structure of the continuum mathematics of theory. Okay, and they are able anyway to, without a loss in theory maybe, they are able to deal with the very complex problems in different fields. In case we can say, for instance, Fuzzy theory, the credibility theory, can be used and are used to deal with the problem of uncertainty, where the main problem is that we have not enough data to describe the uncertainty of the structure. So inside soft computing, we can recognize the computational intelligence. It is a tool, a standard tool in machine learning, artificial intelligence in general, that is the developing a sort of intelligence of a analytical application, of a numerical application, able to find the optimal solution of a problem without evaluating the mathematical structure of the objective function, and in case also of the constraint. And in this case, soft computing is the union of computing intelligence, paradigms, and probabilistic computing. And so we can say that soft computing can be subdivided in different subfields: the FATSI systems, the neural networks, the evolution of computation, and machine learning itself. And about the evolution of computation, the genetic algorithms has been the first application, the first idea developed in this field that now has been absolutely has to be evaluated as one of the number of applications that use a different paradigm to solve some optimization problem. In this case, the soft computing is used to be used in problems that are very hard to be solved with the standard techniques, because the numerical problems, the dimensional problems are very hard. It is sometimes usually it can be very, very more stable than the conventional computing, but it is extremely cost computing. So now let's go inside the structural problems. We typically in structural problems we have this kind of formalization. So we would like to minimize an objective function that depends on a vector x that represents the list of parameters that we can define inside a structural problem. Okay, and the function, the objective function is typically related to the cost of the constructions of the or of the upgrading, but it is subject to a number of inequality or equality that has to be satisfied. That means essentially, for instance, speaking about the problem of structural optimization, that the structure has to be, we would like to get the minimum cost solution, the minimum cost design, able to guarantee all the structural requirement in terms of safety, for instance. So this is the standard formalization of the optimization problem. We can this kind of problem are well known. Maybe the first one has been intuitively defined by Leonardo da Vinci itself when he was studying his the structural behavior of wood structures. But well, typically, even if it is quite older, the classical paradigms are have been not able to solve those kind of problem, except that for typically academic applications, so quite far from the complexity of real cases. Non-classical approaches like soft computing and so genetic algorithms are typically more efficient in this kind of in solving this kind of problem, even if they are more cost they present some very high cost computational. You can see here the first one to formalize the problem of optimization has been Isaac Newton. All of you knows that Isaac Newton, born exactly when the same day when Leonardo da Vinci died. Okay, then a number of different mathematicians and physicians able to formalize and better explain the problem of optimization. But well, now we can deal, and I am showing you how, the problem of structural optimization by using the evolutionary computational or strategies, evolutionary strategies. That means strategies that are not based on mathematical description of the problem, but looking the possible solution as a population of solutions that evolves themselves to get the best solution by exchanging information between them. The first one, the first algorithm has been the genetic algorithms. It is also, it is about 30 years old. And well, here is represented the standard definition of the evolution. And you can see now there is a huge amount of proposal that used different strategies that are based on some biological, physical, or similar way to get an optimal solution with an evolution. Okay, so you can see here this is a sort of list of arguments that are present in the literature. So the first one is the evolutionary algorithms, but we have physical-based algorithms, these swarm-based algorithms, bio-inspired algorithms, nature-inspired algorithms. You can see cuckoo search, for instance, firefly algorithms, and so on. The first one, as I told you, has been the genetic algorithm. So for a clarification point of view, it is a sort of evolution. We produce in the research space of the possible solutions a limited number of possible solutions that are the initial the initial population. Then this population is selected between them, so we get those elements, those individuals able to reach the best solution. Okay, so we do a sort of ranking of the individuals. Then we mix together the information between them, like in a biological systems. And then we do a competition, so we select only the best individuals, and then we define the surviving individuals. And this process go ahead in a loop till we obtain the optimal solution. This is inspired, and this is the reason why we speak about genetic algorithms. This is inspired about the evolution of biological species, and with the theory of Darwin of the evolution. Okay, and well, this is a very fast definition of what we typically do. So we have the children in a human space, but in all the biological reproductive situations, get the best information, some information from the two parents, and they have in some way those information inside them. This is the flow chart. So starting from the population, the fitness evaluation, the selection of the parent, then we have the evolution, that means a crossover, a mutation, a transfer of information, and then the offspring, so a new evolution. And these, the genetic algorithms, and in general the meta-heuristic algorithms, has two main points. So exploration aspect, so they must be able to explore properly the research space, and exploitation, so when once they have information about the an idea of the where is the located the best solution, they must be able to reach it in a faster way. Typically they are not on the same line, so if we have an algorithm able to do a better exploration, it is slower in the exploitation, and vice versa. And this is one of the first the description of the genetic algorithm. And now I go faster. Anyway, I'll give you all the slide about the differences between different way to represent problems. So first of all, the codification on the stopping criteria. We can also improve those arguments using a multi-population strategies, and also using a hybridization between different algorithms. So genetic algorithms with standard ones, or using two different strategies, the ones that is more efficient in exploration, one that is more efficient in exploitations. One of the very promising algorithms is the swarm-based algorithms. The first of all has been the particle swarm optimization, that is a numerical optimization without all of them, without a explicit knowledge of the gradient of the problem. And this has been proposed the first time about in the middle of 19th, if I don't remember wrong. And it is based on showing what typically happens in swarm or fish, in birds or fishes, swarms, when they moved inside an area, getting mainly to reach the best place to get food. Okay, the main objective is to get good food, and the model is based that each element, so each individual has a personal knowledge, so a personal experience, and there is also an additional a global and swarm intelligence, that and there is an interaction between those two kind of information, and so at each point, at each evolutionary step, the position of each individual is updated by a velocity. This velocity tends to get together the information dealing with the personal experience and the swarm experience. with the, so each point moves in a new positions with the two terms, the cognitive terms and social terms. Cognitive term is the personal experience, the social term is the swarm experience, and they can be also organized using different kind of connection, of logical connection between each individuals. And you can see that it is still under the way of be updated, these algorithms. And now I would like to show you how we can use those kind of strategy to a quite basic problem in structural engineering, that is the updating of the retrofitting of existing buildings that is potentially subject to a high risk of earthquake events. So we're speaking about existing buildings that has been constructed in the past without taking in areas where we had hadn't had any information about the seismic risk, and now a deeper knowledge about this risk makes them more vulnerable. And so you have to update his capacity to reduce the safety, to increase the safety at a higher level, okay. And so we can use different strategies. We are speaking about a very common standard in structure engineering. We are speaking about reinforced concrete buildings. And you can see that, well, all of us knows that we can use the FRP or the pre-stressed ribbons or concrete jacketing or steel jacketing that are quite common strategies for retrofitting such a buildings. Okay, but well, how to proceed in identifying what is the best technique between them? Okay, so each of them could be used. Okay, so why FRP instead of pre-stressing or concrete jacketing or steel jacketing? And I'm not speaking about a very simple structure, but in a very complex one, maybe irregular, maybe with a very large areas to be covered. Well, it is not so intuitive. So we can't use our experience, and moreover, we have to take into account the invasivity, the necessity to demolish and rebuild piece of the structures, and to properly evaluate the total costs that are not only the structural ones, as we are a bit in construction stages. And so, well, you can see that well-known biaxial stage, the strength and ductility of the structures, if we are out of the, well, sort of Pareto, so the safety boundary, we have to get back inside the safe area, maybe increasing the strength or increasing the ductility or both of them, okay? Each strategy has its own benefits and cons, and what is the best solution to use? Well, it is not very, very easy to understand. Sometimes it is so complex, taking into account all the effect that each action that we do has on the problem, and that is quite impossible, maybe. Evaluate by our brain which is the optimal solution. We move only on the experience, on what is the technique that we know quite well. Well, we do not know an explicit evaluation in terms of risk reduction and cost increase. Okay, so we would like to get the optimum solution. That means the risk reduction is enough to guarantee the safety at the level required by the codes, and at the same time to reduce as much as possible the cost. Okay, and so how we can deal with these results, where we can put together, we can use particle swarm optimization or genetic or artificial neural network as two, as three different ways to approach this problem. And I would like to show you this example that has been done by with the colleague, my colleague Professor Fabio Di Trapani, still is in working in Turin, in Technical University of Turin with me. We work together. Okay. So the problem is very simply defined. We have a truss structure in reinforced concrete. It is unable to satisfy the minimum requirements in terms of safety under a design earthquake. And we would like to know what are the columns to be retrofitted, with which kind of retrofitting to reduce as much as possible the cost, but at the same time be sure that the safety, required safety is required. Is achieved, and we use the a modified genetic algorithms in this case, and now it is coded in MATLAB. We are working to code it in Python, and the analytical model is the mechanical model is developed with OpenSys, as it is very easy and not very easy, but it is easiest to be interfaced with, with an external program that deals with the optimization problem itself. Okay, and so this is the framework. So we would like to reduce the vulnerability as much as possible, getting the lower cost possible. Okay, and so we just work in terms of two different limit conditions, so the serviceability more than the ultimate limit conditions. This with the aim to control as much as possible the total cost of the structure in terms of retrofitting after an earthquake, so not only preventing the collapse but also preventing collapse under the design earthquake in case of extreme event, but also with reference to a more frequent event, more frequent. So reducing in this case the cost of rehabilitation. Okay, and so the steel jacketing retrofitting in this case is evaluated considering how much is the cost to do not only the structural action but also the local demolishing that sometimes is more is absolutely more important than other costs. Okay, and so we develop an OpenSys model with fiber models to take into account properly the contribution of the concrete and the effect of steel jacketing, and just concentrating on the first floor. This is still an academic application, but in this case we getting a single direction earthquake, and well, you know, this is the formalization of the problem where those are the columns where we could get the reinforcement, not on all of them but only on some of them, where zero without reinforcement, one with reinforcement, and considering that the cost for those for in case of intervention is just to do the demolishing, and the it is greater than zero. Okay, so the problem has been done in terms of ductility demand, okay, so comparing the ductility capacity with the ductility demand, and in this case we design the cost, the total cost is the cost of works on plasters and masonry, and material cost and manpower cost to realize column steel jacketing. Okay, so here we did some hypotheses that are more or less realistic in the Italian context, but just changing the add numbers, they can be updated or adapted to any regions in the world. And you can see that in this case, we forced to have to say that, well, in a sort of intelligent way, the algorithms must be clear to that just getting the intervention on one column as an additional cost, just because you are saying that you have to work on that. Okay, and here you can see the evolution of the design vector. Okay, different solutions for each of different solution, we evaluate the ductility ratio and the fitness, that means the total cost, so the cost of the material and the cost of intervention. And well, we get the more interesting individuals, we put together the solutions that they have, and then recombine this information in a stochastic way, many times, like with biological reproductions, and then we update the population and start again. In this case, we get problem also in a more complex way. So okay, taking into account also the share, the not only the bending, but also the share capacity of the column, and also the effect of the infill inside the structures with some models able to represent them. Okay, and then with a pushover analysis, we did the analysis of the structures, also considering some breaching. And well, those are some results, and I show you in the red are reported the columns subject to the retrofitting, and taking different criteria. And mainly we obtained some interesting results that now we are extending to move to more complex buildings, as we really believe that could be a strong improve, not only from the scientific point of view, but mainly for the practical point of view, to give a sort of assistant able to support the designer in finding the best solution or a number of possible solutions, just where you are at the beginning of the design, where you have no a clear idea what is the best strategy to use. And well, we can go ahead, and I would like to to be extremely fast in this way. In this case, we take into account the effect, the cost effect, both of ultimate states and the ultimate states and the service states. Okay, and take into account the total cost of different events, or the probabilistic cost of the different events, and in this case using a different approach, so considering the FRP, where the cost is of materials related to the number of FRP layers on each columns. Okay, in this case it is also added the possibility to get bracing diameters, so we work both on the strength and on rigidity of the of each column, so of each floors, of course. And in this case, we still used a more fiber model with the with OpenSeas, and those are some results I'm just at the end. The interesting point that I would like to show you is that we can use some of those techniques like genetic algorithms or memetic algorithms to deal with some more complex problem or very complex problem, like such as structural optimization. That is one of the other problem, all these problems in structural engineering, but without a well-defined tool to be solved. And this could be extremely important for not only from the scientific, but also from the technical point of view in supporting decision of designers in problems where the complexity, the intrinsic complexity of the problem could be absolutely greater and not make the problem itself solution not the easiest to be defined properly by the designer. And so sometimes the solution that has been proposed do not take into account all the possible configurations, and maybe that we are losing some of those configurations that maybe they are, even if they are more interesting in terms of safety and money cost control. Okay, I hope to have been not to be very fast. I'm really sorry to be late. Thank you very much for your time. And if you have any question, I will be very happy to reply.
Thank you, Professor Marano. Your presentation was very, very interesting, and you know, as an innovation on the reinforcement approach. I have a question for you. What are the main characteristics of the beams you need to try to apply this approach, this optimization approach? You need the geographical information, the resistance.
At this stage, you have just to say which is the strategy you are using. So,
so it's based on the current codes.
Yes, it is based on, yes, absolutely. It's based on current code. So, well, we did it by OpenSys, as it is more easier to more elastic to be interfaced directly with the with a matter of code, but we are trying to get enough time to make it as a part of a commercial code, because it is based on the standard the definitions. So we get the concrete grade according to the test we did, we have to do, and for the same reason also the steel jacketing or the FRP characteristics. This is anyway an important point. So there are two different aspects. So if we would like to have a design project, so a complete project, we have to do some deal with the complexity, a complete complexity of a standard code. Okay, so the problem itself is very, very complex, okay, and could be extremely time consuming. At the same time, as I am speaking about a drawing support, so a fast drawing, a initial drawing support, design support. So it is it is the stages as you have the white paper in front of you, so just a pencil. So you have to define the first decision. Okay, so which is the best strategy? Why FRP and not steel jacketing or concrete jacketing? Okay, it is quite important to approach with this problem with a support that could be not related to the complete to the total complexity. It could be dealing with a relax a problem, so a simplified ones, okay, that you, after you define the design strategy, you can approach in a more details to each of the aspects that you are not taking into account. So, for instance, in a steel structure, you can't, or well, you have to know that if you approach with a very complete analysis at the early stage, you have to deal also with the junctions details. Okay, you can overlap, you can skip this at the initial stage. You just go on the sides definition of the structures, and then with a local analysis, you can do a more detailed analysis and design of those aspects. Okay, so a 2-3 stage analysis could be also very interesting, because it could be very easiest and presents a huge amount of computational cost reduction. And at the same time, also you have you can focus it on the main parameters of the initial design, and then you can go ahead in a more details for a detailed design that has less effects on total cost of the structure itself, usually.
Thank you for your reply. We have another question from Professor Umberto Barun.
Okay.
You can see on the screen that the tools you presented can drastically change the way we approach our structures in design, assessment, and strengthening. What should the university do to prepare our civil engineer course or civil engineering students to this path?
Yes, Professor Barum is absolutely right.
Yes, I was thinking right now what we need to do to.
Yes. Okay. As I told you, well, the amount of knowledge we have to deal with, in not just in structural engineering in general, as a civil engineering, the amount of information we have to deal with are growing up faster and faster. And last 20 years has been devastating in this sense. And Professor Varun is absolutely right. Moreover, civil engineering has some basic tools that are still the same. So designing a reinforced concrete beam, okay, is something that all of us has to know in an intuitive way. So we have to study for this. We can cancel some part of our knowledge. We have to be able to insert, to upgrade some of our programs in civil engineering to get as a standard tool the new techniques like those one. Maybe for some aspect I would like to try to give a parallel. As 30 years ago, when the finite element model was growing up as knowledge and as capacity. Till then, we have been people, not me, was used to do the calculation in a very simple way. So if you think what our colleagues that designed great bridges, great opera anyway, okay, but just doing the calculations without computers, it's unbelievable for us, okay? And we can't forget that we have been on the moon just using computational power that is 100 of times shorter and smaller than I have in my mobile phone that I am used to see what is happening on Facebook, okay? So it is absolutely incredible, but we are speaking about order of magnitude of innovation. We have to give the right way to use them, not to be an expert, but to be a right user of new technologies.
Okay, thank you. We have another question. My Italian is broke, as I told you before we start here.
Yes, no, I can try to translate this kind of instrument of approach could be used for the monitoring and maintenance, the decision process in large structures such as bridges. Do you have of an estimation of how much it is consuming? Well, it is a very interesting field of research. Yes, there are some applications, but just now some big companies like IBM or Google are working exactly on this topic, okay? And there are no closed tools till now. I think that in a couple of years will be, and the cost of the software is really easy to be controlled, because they have to use some standard tools that we can get directly if we are some just a little bit dummy. Okay, we can work on Python libraries that are for free. Okay, or in MATLAB there are also other libraries that are quite well defined. The main cost is about the software, yes, but also about the strategy of data acquisition and data and data analysis, and also about the capacity of getting together the all the data. So big data analysis, that's right.
Thank you, Professor Marano. I would like to thank you for your time, for your presentation.
It's been a pleasure. I would like to thank Professor Di Trapani that helps me in preparing this presentation.
See. And I hope meet you personally in Italy in the next year.
I would be very happy to meet you next year, maybe in Turin. You will be a glad host in our university, of course.
Thank you, Professor. Good afternoon for you.
Thank you, everybody, and thank you to you and to all the organizers for this extremely interesting event. It's been really a pleasure for me to attend to the presentations and to give this speech. Thank you very much.